بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا مولانا محمد عليه وعلى آله أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. Welcome back to another episode of Saviors of Islam, where we look at one icon that has left a beautiful legacy behind in the Muslim world. Now, one of the most beautiful icons and dearest figures to me from the companions, and of course there are many, رضي الله عنهما جميعا, may Allah be pleased with them, but one figure that stands out is Anas ibn Malik. And Anas ibn Malik is a very exceptional figure in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes to Medina, and when he arrives in Medina, everybody goes greeting him. Some people come with gifts, some people come with kind words, and everybody's excited to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anas ibn Malik's mother comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and says, "Ya Rasulullah, I don't have anything to give you. I don't have any gifts. I'm not the richest of people, but I do have a son, and he's very bright and he's very capable. And he's young, he's 7, 10 years of age. And I would like to commit him to your service so he can grow up in your household, live with you, spend the days with you, come and sleep at night in the house. And then that way he can serve you during the day and learn from you." Now, of course, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam welcomed the opportunity to have Anas with him. And Anas ibn Malik built this amazing bond with the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So Anas ibn Malik goes on to share all of these beautiful ahadith. And he's considered to be one of the most important transmitters of hadith. All those figures that we discussed before, all those great imams, many of them in their chains of narrations would eventually go back to Anas in the knowledge that they transmitted about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and in the knowledge that he acquired directly from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Anas ibn Malik would go on to tell us how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat, how he stood, how he prayed, how he used the miswak. What did he tell the companions when he stood in the prayer, right? When he commanded them to line up, what words did he use? How did he carry himself? What was his, you know, the softness of his skin? All these little details were captured by Anas ibn Malik. Some of the stories that really, really touch the heart with Anas ibn Malik, perhaps one of my favorites, is the story of Anas ibn Malik when he was invited to a dinner with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes Anas ibn Malik with him, and Anas ibn Malik sits on the right of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and on the left are two wise men like Abu Bakr and Umar. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is given something to drink, and he drinks. And now Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam has to make a decision. The sunnah is to pass whatever, and back then they used to share the mug or share the container. So he has to pass the food or the water. Now, if he's going to pass to the right, that will be the sunnah, that will be the tradition. But it would be giving the precedence or the respect to a young child who's 7 years of age, 8 years of age, and it might unintentionally show disrespect to the two wise men. And if he gives it to the two wise men, it might be disrespectful also to the child who's there. And of course, it will be breaking the sunnah, breaking the tradition. So what does he do? He turns to the young boy and he says, "أتأذنوا لي أن أسقي هؤلاء؟ أتأذن لي أن أسقي الشيخين؟ Do you give me permission to allow them, the two wise men, to drink first?" And the boy says, "La, no, I don't give them permission." I want you to imagine if this was anybody else. Imagine if this was your own son in front of guests, in front of people that invited you for dinner, says no to you. It would be a little bit of an awkward situation, but an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled it off and says, "Laka hadha, it is your right, no issue at all." And of course, the young boy drank, and then they passed on the mug to the two wise men. Now, later on, the scholars of hadith would say that perhaps one of the reasons why Anas ibn Malik wanted to drink first before passing on the mug is he wanted to consolidate the blessings of drinking from the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ's or from the place where the lips of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ touched on the mug. And of course, we believe that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was blessed in his body, was blessed in various aspects of his life, and we do believe in that barakah that was given exclusively to Rasulullah ﷺ. So that's again a story of Anas ibn Malik showing us, demonstrating the gentleness of Rasulullah ﷺ. Another beautiful story: and Nabi ﷺ once trusts Anas ibn Malik with a secret. He gives him a message and he says, "Go deliver this message." Anas ibn Malik gets excited. He goes to deliver the message and he finds some kids in Medina playing hide and seek. So he comes and he joins them and he plays hide and seek with them. So Nabi ﷺ is looking for Anas. Anas is not coming. It's been a long time. So Nabi ﷺ goes looking for Anas physically. And he finds Anas closing his eyes like this, playing hide and seek with members, like other kids in the community. So Nabi Sallam comes from behind where Anas ibn Malik is. And imagine Anas ibn Malik has his eyes closed and he has his hand or palm over his eyes like this. And he's counting down, you can imagine. So Nabi Sallam, he comes and he places his hand where Anas's hand was. So imagine Anas's hand is here. He displaces or pushes Anas's hand down in a gentle way. And then Nabi Sallam makes his voice deep. He says, Anas, do you know who it is? Do you know who it is? And Anas ibn Malik, he tells us, I knew that it was Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam because of the softness of his skin and because of the odor and because of the way that he carried himself. But I wanted to just continue. You know, I wanted to enjoy the moment. So I pretended that I didn't. And I said, I don't know, who could it be? Who could it be? And then I turn, or he turns my face and he shows that it's Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And of course, he doesn't even mention the message. In another narration, he says, what happened to the message? And Anas ibn Malik remembers and goes to deliver the message right away. Another beautiful incident with Anas ibn Malik is that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam trusts Anas with a secret, and he tells him, do not divulge this secret. So imagine he would be, as a young child, moving around some information from some of the local community members of the community would be receiving messages directly from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Anas ibn Malik goes to deliver this message, goes to deliver this secret, and then he goes back home. And his mom says, how was your day today? What did you do with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? He says to her, I can't tell you. Today was a special day. There was a secret that I cannot share with you. Well, you can tell me, I'm your mom. Absolutely not. This is the secret of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's high state, official, public, or private matters, private secret matters that I cannot share with you. And they're very important to the state. So imagine years pass when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam passes away. And after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam passes away, people, the companions, used to tease Anas. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away a long time. Tell us, what were the secrets? Tell us some of those things that, you know, the messages that were exchanged. Tell us a little bit more. We're excited. We want to know. And Anas ibn Malik would say, I have protected what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked me to keep private while he's alive. And there's no way I would dishonor that after he's passed on. Anas ibn Malik spent 10 years serving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the most beautiful of ways. And that 10-year period allowed them to spend quite a bit of time together and allowed Anas to see into the private life of Rasulullah. So nobody knew Anas as a child better than, or nobody knew Rasulullah better than Anas from a child's point of view. So Anas ibn Malik, he is, you know, going to narrate all of these beautiful stories, as we mentioned. He's going to narrate all of these beautiful situations in the Prophet Muhammad's life that really demonstrate his genuineness, his ikhlas, his sincerity. And of course, Anas ibn Malik, he receives three du'as from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi looks at Anas ibn Malik and says, oh Anas, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you a long life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you plenty of wealth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow you to have a beautiful long life, beautiful wealth, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you with as many kids as your heart desires. Now Anas ibn Malik went on to have more than 30 descendants, more than 30 kids and grandkids that he witnessed during his life. Some people actually say even more than 40, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Anas ibn Malik went on to live to be the second last companion to pass away. Some say he lived to 103. Some people actually say he lived to 94, 93, 96 years of age. So somewhere in that area, he lives to be the second oldest companion to pass away. So he witnesses the time of Abu Bakr, the time of Umar, the time of Uthman, the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib, Muawiyah, Yazid, Hassan, Hussein. He witnesses much of the civil tension between the Muslim community. He witnesses all of that, and he's commenting, you know, on these situations, reminding them what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. And he, of course, makes a lot of money selling, and as a businessman, he has a beautiful trade that he is able to accomplish a lot of wealth through. And of course, when he would be trading, buying and selling, he would stand with the people and tell them, you know what, I have much greater than this product. I have the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I can tell you what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. His direct words. I can tell you how he was like. Finally, after years of traveling to all these different places, he comes back as an old man, you know, walking on his cane, going back to Medina. And he finds that the children of Medina have waited at the gates of Medina, waiting for Anas. Oh, wow, subhanAllah, Anas ibn Malik, the one who was a child and served Rasulullah sallam, he's coming back as an old man. We want to learn from him. Tell us, how was Rasulullah sallam like? And so Anas ibn Malik, he sits with them and he tells them, I have traveled to this place and that place, and I have seen this person and that person. He's well-traveled, he's rich. The dua of Rasulullah sallam for him has come true. He says, Wallahi, I have not come across someone more gentle, more kind, more loving. I have served Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 years. Never did he say to me, why did you do this when I did something? Or why didn't you do this when I didn't do something? You would rarely hear the word no from his mouth. Anytime that he had the capacity to do something for someone, he would do it. And then he would tell the companions now, and these are the grandkids of the companions and grandkids of the people that Anas ibn Malik grew up with. And subhanAllah, he would go on to tell them all these beautiful stories about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, including how a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to come back from outside Medina, and the first thing that he would do is he would line up, the kids of Medina would stand and line up with him, and they would want to play with him. And so they would get up and say, can we play, Ya Rasulullah, can we play? And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam would take one of them, and he would put that child in front of him on the camel. Someone else would go behind on the camel, and they would go and play from Fajr time all the way till before Dhuhr, until the kids themselves were bored, subhanAllah. Later on, the companions themselves would tease one another, and they would say, you know what, Rasulullah loved me more than he loved you. Why? Because he put me on the camel in front of him, but he put you behind. And then, of course, the response would be, well, he put me twice on the camel, and he only put you once. So they would tease each other that way. And Anas ibn Malik captured that private, beautiful moments of Rasulullah ﷺ with kids in the community. For example, when a child is brought to Rasulullah ﷺ, an infant actually, and the infant urinates on the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ does not panic, does not, you know, drop the child. Of course, he comforts the child, and the mother is so embarrassed. Please let me clean. Let the baby be. So all of these beautiful moments, capturing the lens of a child looking at the Prophet Muhammad's life and transmitting that, come from Anas ibn Malik. Now let's look at some. We said that Anas ibn Malik, you know, he transmitted, you can say that he's the third most hadith, he has basically transmitted the third highest number of a hadith from a Nabi Sallam directly. And that makes him a great source of authority. What were some of those hadith that he transmitted? He says, and Nabi Sallam says, اِعْتَدِلُوا فِي السُّجُودِ وَلَا يَبْسُطُ أَحَدَكُمْ ذِرَاعَيْهِ إِنْبِسَاطِ الْكَلْبِ. You know, when you're standing, stand straight. And when you are prostrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, prostrate with strength. Don't let your body dangle, and don't let your arms dangle. Rather, and don't be like when a dog places their arms on the ground. So don't do that. So Anas ibn Malik is the one who narrated the hadith of yassiru wa la tu'assiru wa bashiru wa la tunaffiru. Share good news, make things easy, don't make things hard. Share good news, don't push people, don't deter people. That was the hadith transmitted by Anas ibn Malik. La yu'minu ahadukum hatta yuhib li akhihi ma yuhib li nafsi. The hadith of no one will be truly believing until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. And the hadith of no one will truly believe until you love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than you love yourself. The hadith about the ta'un, about the plague, narrated by Anas ibn Malik. Other hadith about the person showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after eating and drinking. What you should say, the adhkar after eating, after drinking, after going into the bathroom, leaving from the bathroom. So many of these adhkar that now we take for granted come from this individual named Anas ibn Malik. And one last thing that we want to highlight is, like everybody else that we mentioned in this series so far, he stood against injustice. So he made his way all the way to the Khalifa to complain about the injustice of Al-Hajjaj. He stood in front of Al-Hajjaj himself, and Al-Hajjaj threatened him and said, I will do this and I will do that to you. And he says, I don't care what you do to me. Let me make it very clear to you, I disagree with what you have done. And I know that you will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you will be held accountable. May Allah guide you, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easier for you. And if not, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow you to see that which you deserve. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be like those that walked in the footsteps of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to learn the lives of the saviors of Islam, connect with them, whether they're from the companions or the tabi'een or the later on generations. Every night, inshallah ta'ala, join us at 8:30 p.m. for a very brief look into one of the lives and the lessons from one of the lives of somebody who changed Islamic history and left a beautiful legacy behind. Jazakumullah khairan, subhanak allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka natubu alayk, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.